I'm going to introduce John, who will chair this session. I'm Alan Paller. I'm the founder of SANS. And for 14 years, John ran Gartner's security group. And he wouldn't call me very often, but every single time he called me, it was to tell me how wrong I was. So about 3.5 years ago, he calls me up and he says, I want to talk to you. And my stomach goes, "Rrr." And so I go meet him and he says, I think I can do more good at SANS than I'm doing at Gartner, so I'm coming. So about then he came and he has continued to do what he always did, which was talk to the users, see what the users needed, shape what the vendors would deliver when the vendors were shapeable, but all for free. So he doesn't charge for it, so there isn't any kind of, if you pay, you get a good Gartner upper right kind of quadrant thing. But John and I have been working on this particular project for a little over a year, that we know that security people don't do a wonderful job when they brief boards of directors. We know that from feedback from boards. What we didn't know was what works and what doesn't work. So we ran a whole series, I think five or six, sessions where we brought lots of CISOs together, we brought lots of audience together, we began to bring directors together. What you're going to hear is what we think we know. And this time, really for the first time, we're pretty sure we've got a nugget. A nugget to me is something we give you that sometime 2 years from now you say, oh, you know what you told me? That really worked. So that's a nugget. So I think we've got a nugget in here that you'll be able to put to work pretty soon if you have to brief any kind of senior level boards. But with that, let me let John take the first half.
Okay, thanks, Alan. Welcome, everyone. I sort of missed the part where Lalani said your seat cushion may float if we go down in flames here. So we'll skip that part. As Alan mentioned, one of the fun things I get to do at SANS is sort of help the security community. And Alan's genius years ago was if SANS helps the security community, gets bigger, then there's more people for SANS to train. And SANS benefits as well as you guys benefit. I'll give you the sort of end result. Let me do a little level check here first. How many in the audience are today working as CISOs or working CISOs? Of you are, how many of you have already briefed the board or regularly briefed the board? Okay. How many do it at least quarterly? Okay, so you're an experienced crowd. So we want to keep that in mind. And as we go through this, I can skip my first slide because this is what I thought boards of directors were like. When we first started this project, a bunch of guys in suits who yelled at anybody who brought up bad news, or the audit guy in the back blew bubbles trying to make everything seem happier than it really was as the board got going. So what we're going to do here is sort of go through three things. Some of the strategies we heard back from CISOs that they learned to use when briefing the board and preparing to brief the board. We're going to focus a lot on having something meaningful to say, having data, meaningful data about the company's security program. And then Alan's going to come up and go through a great session on how to present the data, what's worked in ways to present the data to C-level and boards to get the right things to happen. Goal here, we may go through this entire CISO level presentation without even mentioning the dreaded R word, without mentioning risk. We're going to actually talk about security and the measurements of real life security programs. And we're going to play some audio clips of the people we talked to of the director level and the CISO level. So let's get started. So in 14 years of dealing with CISOs and security teams at Gartner and 4 more years at SANS, started to see some common characteristics of CISOs who succeeded. And by succeeded, I mean they protected the company and the customers. They weren't on the front pages. They weren't on the breach list. Stuff happened, but they controlled it. And when you start looking at it, when you look at the problem and you start looking at what's the difference between companies who got breached and companies who didn't, the security things we need to do, we pretty much know the things we need to do, whether it's encryption or prevention or faster reaction or incident response. We can train people. SANS makes a good business training people how to do the security part, but inevitably it turns out other people have to do things, whether it's the user, whether it's business line managers, whether it's IT admins who won't take care of their systems well, or software developers that don't do the right things security-wise. The programs that succeed are the ones who convince those other people to do these things. And as we all know, anytime you can get the upper level to help you, get your peers to do something, it's easier. And that's one key thing to keep in mind when briefing the board. Part of the key charge of all of you guys to brief the board is to inform them so they know of what's coming up, of what the status is, but it's also to try to get their support to change things, to increase security, which may actually mean we decrease some of the spending we're doing in security if we really do it well, and we're going to touch on some of that. The real key is driving change. This conference gets bigger and bigger every year. There's more and more vendors every year because too many things are not changing. We're chasing our tails the same ways. We're going to try to point to some successful programs that have changed things. So I'd like to take a sort of what works sort of view of things, separate the hype from the reality of briefing the board. We have a lot of practitioners out here. You guys are briefing the board, so I hope we hit the nail there. We're building on both of us for the past 15, 20 years working with CISOs and directors and sort of building our mental model, but then backed with this year's worth of discussion with a number of people on boards and a whole bunch of CISOs I'll show you. And there's the various cities we ran this in that Alan was talking about. So I'd like to start with some data, and every year I take a look at the Identity Theft Resource Center numbers. They're sort of very impartial. They do it the same way every year. It's not funded selling products or anything. It's pretty good data. In 2016, last year, there were 980 documented breaches that were made public last year. If you're interested in the growth, that's about a 20% growth over the 781 or so that happened in 2015. So one line, we got 20% growth in breaches, but then you start thinking, well, the Fortune 10,000, 9,000 companies did not appear on that list. 90% of the companies did not appear on the public list. What were they doing differently that they were able to avoid those damaging breaches? Another way to look at the numbers, this year, or in 2016, the average breach was 36,000 records. In 2015, the average breach was 215,000 records. So even the ones that were breached, some of the ones were able to more quickly detect the breach, or they were able to protect more of their databases across the company. I did look into the data. In 2016, there were a lot more smaller businesses, state agencies that were breached, but there was still a lack of those large 20 million, 10 million. A lot of bigger companies had smaller breaches. They were changing something from years past. If they couldn't prevent it, they more quickly detected it and more rapidly mitigated it. That's success. That's a successful security program as well. When we start looking at the individual cases and the people we dealt with and the people we talked to, it really is the difference maker is the quality of the security team starting at the CISO level. And we're going to drill down into that side of things and get to the numbers they were able to get. If you look at the sort of start at the base level, every successful CISO does have to have that base level understanding of security and vulnerabilities, what it means, what are vulnerabilities in software as a base level. And the people in the security team obviously have to have that as well. That's critical. But the next step is really where the force multiplier starts to happen, where you understand within your industry or your vertical or your particular company what the dangers are, what the threats are, what the value is, and how things get done. How does something actually happen? How does the company make money? How do business unit guys get things approved that are going to roll out new services? How does IT get projects approved? How does security get plugged in? And then the ability to balance those two demands, to understand the threats to your business and understand which solutions will work and which won't. I can solve shoplifting in retail today if we just attach tractor tires to everything we're selling in our stores. No more shoplifting. The security solution will be worse than the problem. And all too often, we did hear back that quite often the security solutions proposed are as bad as or worse than the problem they were trying to solve. So it's important to understand in your business, in manufacturing, and in trying to get doctors to do things or academics, it's very different. And the security solutions that may work in one place won't work in the other. So it's that ability to drive action that means understanding the motivations, understanding what is going to work, what the threats are, and then drive action to make those changes happen. And the bottom line piece that came across from boards is when they were presented with a connection, the current status of the security program, the current status of the company in cybersecurity, proposed strategic actions that would have some measurable business benefit to change that, and then reporting that showed continual reporting against where we were and where we are now. That's what boards are looking for. If you think about it, boards are used to years and years of hearing from the chief financial officer, who reports the numbers the same way month after month after month. And you know what? Most months the CFO has bad news. One myth is that boards of directors expect we're going to never have bad news. We're going to fail if we ever tell them bad things will happen. That's not true. They're used to hearing bad things from business managers, CFOs, but they're used to hearing it in their language. They're used to hearing it in repeatable ways and in numerical ways that they can compare the past, the current, and projections we make of the future in terms that make sense to them on the business side. So we talked to a bunch of security CISOs at a bunch of different levels. Going to play a couple audio clips from Steve Martino of Cisco. Shelly Archambault, who's the CEO of MetricStream, is also on the boards of Nordstrom and Verizon, a few other places. We had city level CISOs, Gary Hayslip, Kim Jones was in the financial world at Vantiv at the time, Jason Callahan in the pharmaceutical side in a medium-sized company. Zan Vortrinow ran network security for the Air Force for many years and retired, is now on several boards. Nate Fick is the CEO of Endgame. He's also on the board of his alma mater, Dartmouth. And Josh Davis of Qualcomm had some of the greatest inputs, but he's the only person in security you can't find a picture of. So he's got the best avatar of all, and we also didn't capture any audio clips of him. He doesn't show up on magnetic tape in any way. Something to be suspicious of when you're dealing with Qualcomm. So let me play a couple clips here from Shelly and then from Steve of CISO, and then we'll drill down on what we hear.
Focus on what they want to see is strategy. What they want to see is how we're there for addressing the strategy. And to the extent that there are metrics that you use and look at that are helpful for them to understand and see on a regular basis so they can see progress.
And we asked them was, how important is cybersecurity to your digitization strategy? And that almost that same percentage came back and said it was critically important. And I thought, as interesting as that was, that about 40% of them said they had halted programs to innovate their business models because of concerns over cybersecurity. So it's shifting from be a protector, a safety net to an enabler to these businesses. And I think that's where we all have to move from, yes, we have to protect everything and make those balance and risk, but how do we also enable the business to do these new things in a secure way? Produce these great reports about all the vulnerabilities, and they'd give it to their IT counterparts, and their IT counterparts would go, thank you very much, and put it in the round file cabinet. The IT people that I went and talked to were frustrated that my team kept coming to them and saying, here, fix this, and it wasn't their priority. And I think that notion of aligning your priorities and understanding where there's a synergy in those priorities is the way to a good, successful, strong, collaborative partnership. And I said, this is a problem that we needed to solve.
I'm going to show you the results of some of Steve's efforts there. Well, what we heard from Shelly was boards want to hear about strategy from anybody with a C in their title. And another quote was, boards are not ATM machines. They're not there to give you resources, people, or dollars. They don't do that for the business units. That's not their job. Hearing about strategy from people with C in their titles and then seeing how that strategy works and hearing how that strategy is going to connect to business is key. And from Steve's side, you heard the same thing, that members of their board are already starting to ask business units about the cybersecurity issues of new initiatives and not approving funding for new initiatives if they're not considering cybersecurity. This is becoming a more regular concern of boards, and they want to see that connection. What can the security team do? What are the strategies from the CISO that are going to enable these new business initiatives or these mergers and acquisitions? So I want to transition into what type of data, how do we do that? And it's not simply the usual type of security data. We have to show that our strategies are focused on protecting the business and that we're expressing that in business terms and that we're focusing and demonstrating both effectiveness against threats, but also efficiency. One big part that's missing in most security strategies and presentations is how are we reducing the cost of doing the old stuff in security? You think the manufacturing guy gets to stand up and say, oh yeah, our production costs are the same as they were last year, now we need money for new machines. No, it's that old stuff, the easy stuff in security, we're reducing the cost of. Now our strategy is then to take some of that and change some other things and invest in ways to stop advanced threats or allow business to be more digital, more connected, allow a quicker time to market, and so on. We have to express what we're doing in business benefits, not security features. Right? Security features are meaningless to anybody outside the security group. You know, the reality is what boards of directors in their minds are thinking is, we're self-insuring ourselves in this company, and is this person capable of doing that? Or should we start looking at maybe we get a cheaper CISO and we spend money on AIG for cyber insurance? Cyber insurance is competing with funds for what we do in security. We need to show how we protect the business, because the reality is cyber insurance does not protect our customers or our business. It merely reduces liability a tiny bit in most cases. So in order to do that, we need to have meaningful security metrics that we're collecting and then we can be presenting to the board. And seen in talking across these parties, there's sort of four types of security metrics. The first two are sort of the most important ones, bless you, and the ones we want to talk about. We want to show them things that will help get approval for strategic initiatives to drive change and increasing efficiency and effectiveness. We also want to do our job in informing them and giving warning if something may happen or something's happening threat-wise or industry-wise or other things, give them warning and say what we're doing about it. There's two other key elements of those metrics. We do need to demonstrate value from the security program. If a typical company is spending 7% of the IT budget on cybersecurity, that's a big investment for every company, and we're competing with funds for a lot of areas. The final one, none of the directors like this, but we do need to at least give them a busy box, so they have some dials and knobs they can look at and play with while we get on with the important stuff as we keep going. None of the directors like that on the webinar. Here's some examples that I've collected over the past couple of years of expressing gains and efficiencies and effectiveness in ways that touch or make more sense to boards of directors and others. So for example, on the effectiveness side, rather than saying we're now 99% effective in stopping advanced persistent threats, to be able to say that we can now approve a business use of a new technology, a new cloud service or something, in 1 week instead of 3 weeks. Or we can sign on new business partners more quickly because we can do a better risk evaluation because we have a way of mitigating risks if somebody is allowed to connect or some new application is allowed to connect without full security vetting. If you're lucky enough to be in an industry that does measure downtime, whether it's manufacturing or online retail, showing that security downtime is reducing month over month as a portion of the downtime is a key one to tie in. Customer defections, you know, the bottom one, security is a competitive business factor. We tend to shy away from that sometimes, like in banking, they've never wanted to say, we're safer than Citibank. But when you start looking at why products are succeeding in the markets these days, things like iPhones have security and safety features built in that gave it an advantage. Why didn't the Microsoft Windows phone succeed in the market? It wasn't just usability, there's lots of things Apple thought about or Google and its services about getting security baked in as competitive factors. And if we can drive that side of the house, we can more easily tie with business. The efficiency side, again, reducing cost of protection, response, and mitigation show up in the bottom line, and we end up with a lot of friends in other parts of the company who are often willing to pay for security solutions if they're reducing their costs. I'll show you some examples in the next slide. Oh, first I want to show you Steve's sort of summary slide. So this is an example of sort of a little bit of a sanitized example, but really similar, very similar to what Steve does show the board. So if you look at those two crossing curves, those are what he chose to call universal security metrics, and they would show the board trends in. The red line is what percent of vulnerabilities are closed on time. So there's vulnerabilities discovered. If it's on a desktop, it might be a 5-day SLA. If it's on a server, it might be a 2-week, 3-week, whatever. What percent are closed on time? And the blue one is, at any given instant, what percent of known vulnerabilities are open? If you look to the left, you see they had a problem back in 2012. They're making slow progress of the blue line coming down and the red going up. When Steve, through briefing the board and working with the CIO coming in, the Cisco, got the CIO to work with him and the IT side and the security operations side to work together to change the ways vulnerabilities were considered, analyzed, and worked, and those curves started to cross. So now they're in the ranges where they're supposed to be, where a vulnerability look says, okay, the lines are where they're supposed to be. If there's a change in direction of either those lines, as part of his briefing to the board, Steve explaining why. Now, sure, go ahead.
A few of you move forward so you can see the slides. And some of you are thinking, gee, that's a little hard to read. That wouldn't be a good thing to show the board. It turns out that if you show the same charts every quarter, after the first time, they like a much richer, more detailed set of pictures, not the pie charts for dummies. So when somebody tells you, oh no, you don't want all that detail, they're wrong. I just, that was a moment, a teaching moment.
Yeah, there's an old, I'm in the Washington DC area where the myth is, you can never show the general more than three bullets on the slide. Can you imagine if they really made decisions that way? What Steve has also included here on the left-hand side are the more traditional quantity ones. Here's how many attacks we blocked. 5.4 million emails were inspected. So many web sessions. Those are great to just give an idea of how much work's going on, but do you think the manufacturing guy says, here's how many raindrops the new roof on the manufacturing facility blocked? No, we don't care. Nobody really cares about that. The real important number, and again, this is a sanitized version, if you look down at the bottom in the blue line, what he's reporting on in more detail and obviously in closed sessions, mean time to detect an incident should be under 24 hours, mean time to mitigate or contain under 36 hours. Those are by far the two most meaningful metrics in security programs because we can't say what percent we stopped. We have to report on stuff happens, how quickly do we deal with it, and is that curve going down over time? Just like defects in manufacturing, it's really key. Now, I'm going to give you a couple examples of other ways CISOs have initiated change and gotten some really good data. One of the most fun things I do at SANS, we call it the What Works program, is where vendors give me customers, we interview them and do examples. RSA didn't accept it this year, but you can look back the past 2 years, I did RSA sessions showing other examples in this area. And let me give you a few of those ideas before I turn it back over to Alan. Healthcare CISO, this is actually Jim Ralph at Aetna. When he took the job at Aetna, he knew that they needed work on their software development lifecycle and reducing vulnerabilities on their websites. He went to the VP of App Dev. They made a deal to work together, went to the board and said, we want to do this strategic initiative over the next 2 years. We believe if the company invests $5 million over 2 years, we can bring you $10 million in direct savings. And what they ended up after 2 years working, there's a sigil effort called the Building Security and Maturity Model to improve your software development lifecycle and compare yourself against your peers. The VP of App Dev was able to stand up and say, we've reduced the time to market for new apps by 30%, getting through the gates of QA and everything. And we actually increased our software productivity by 15%, or decreased our software cost by 15%. More secure code, faster to market, and cheaper. Well, wait a minute, that's not what happened when NASA went to a secure development lifecycle. Well, in private industry, with more reuse, with getting better practices in, this is what happened. This is real data that he was able to go to the board to justify the next round of changes. Simpler one in the university side, higher ed. This, I think, was a FireEye deployment. They found out by deploying devices, they could shorten, they almost doubled the amount of intrusions they were detecting. They looked worse at that level. Whoa, we're worse than we were. Why we show that? Well, by detecting more quickly, they were able to catch things when it was one or two machines and reduce IT's cost of dealing with an incident and repaving machines and reduce the incident cost by 35%. This was paid for by the IT side of things, who bears the cost of doing these things. A banking side was rolling out privilege management and application control. As they went to Windows 7 in this case, and they used to re-image four machines per week due to malware and phishing type attacks. They got that down to one every 3 months. Another effort that was paid for out of the IT department. Reduced the security cost, didn't cost the security budget anything, and these were metrics that the CISO could then report on progress made. Simple one. tools to enable a single firewall administrator to more rapidly address the risk of connecting SAP over here to this system over there to this business partner led to shortening the approval time for new connections from 2 weeks to 1 day. It also dramatically increased the security of knowledge of what their firewall policy was doing. The board doesn't care about that. The board cares about we can now do business more quickly. We can now connect the partners. That's a good thing. That's something the security program benefited the business.
So remember job one, you've got to build trust. You've got to become a part of the culture, not look at the culture with petulance. Become a part of that culture so that you can influence that culture. Do your homework. That's the intel gathering. The metrics do matter. The board is not your ATM. And the last one I keep repeating, because again, the last case of a former peer of mine who did this was actually just 6 months ago, unfortunately. Never try and surprise your ELT in front of the board. It's gauche, it's inappropriate, it's unprofessional, and you won't last long as my peer.
So that was Kim Vaniv, Kim Jones at the time was CISO Vaniv. The job one is get the board to trust you, get them to believe you deserve the C in your title. And that is express things in their language and talk business. Do your homework, understand who's on the board, understand where cybersecurity's handle. Is it the audit committee, the technology committee, the R word committee, where cybersecurity might be handled. Metrics are important. Board is there to hear about strategy and improve strategy, not resources. And then finally, don't rat out your CEO or your CIO at the board. That's not the appropriate point to do that. So with that, sort of wanted to get across from what we heard back from CIOs, CISOs about the important data to have and the metrics, how to do it. Now Alan's gonna come up and show you some great examples of how to present it and how to get the story across.
Thank you, John. A very long time ago, well, let me just show it to you. Don't talk about it. You get an email, it's from the CIO, says the board of directors meeting next week, they want to be briefed on cybersecurity, you're on their agenda. How many of you have had roughly that one? Watch this. How many of you haven't had that one? How many of you won't raise your hand no matter what I ask you? So for about 3 years of my life, I spent teaching technologists and scientists how to give presentations that would cause people to do what you want them to do. And one of the little tiny lessons is never ask an audience how many of you agree. Because if I asked you how many are women and how many are men, 20% would drop out. You'd be kind of wondering, well, what? It's not a San Francisco thing. This is what, what is he going to tell me if I choose one of those or the other? I'm not at all sure I want to raise my hand anyway. So if you ever need an audience to look like they're agreeing with you, say, how many of you don't think that's a good idea? And only three mean people will raise their hands. Anyway, so you didn't need to know it. So this is a meeting in which you are on display probably for the first time at that level. And one of the characteristics that a lot of people don't know about presentations is your audience is judging you at every minute. They actually can describe you in characteristics. They can describe John, they can describe Alan, they can describe Leilani, they can describe everybody that they give their time to listen to. And they have very strong adjectives and adverbs that they use, one positively or negatively, meaning they develop a very strong opinion. So if you do a really crappy job with this audience, how are you going to do long term? They don't forget, by the way. Oh, you were the guy who told us that, remember? They remember you. So it's a high-risk moment. So what I'm going to try to give you are the ways to avoid the really big bad things that can happen. We'll all find our own bad things we can do, but the really big ones I think I can help you stay away from. We talked to a lot of people. John found lots of CSOs. We found a reasonable number of board members. Shelley Archambault was by far the best. She's a board member of Verizon and Arbitron, and I don't think she's still on the Nordstrom board. She's on another one. She's CEO of a risk management firm, not a cyber risk management firm, but a risk management firm, a public firm. So she understands the language of risk and that. But more importantly, she understands both sides. She understands what we're trying to say, and she understands what the board's trying to hear. And it turns out most boards have one or two people that they defer to on all technology and especially all cybersecurity things. So if you can find that person, get to be friends with them, that's a shortcut to doing a good job because they'll ask that person how you did. They'll all listen and then they'll say, hey, John, how did he do? So She was that one person on all the boards she's on. She said so. They always ask me. But she's this unique person. I was lucky. I had a mentor all through my young days named Jim Webb. He was the guy who promised Kennedy he'd put a man on the moon, and he did it. He built NASA and he put a man on the moon. And he would tell stories. And when he told stories, they were rich and wonderful, and I could sit and listen. Sitting and listening to Shelley is like that. So I actually have about almost 5 minutes spread out through this of Shelley talking, because she'll make the point, because remember, she's who you're talking to. She's the person that they defer to on the board. So her words are gonna be really important. I'll try to adapt them to you. She's gonna ask a bunch of questions. Before I do it, I want you to raise your hand. I know a bunch of you aren't gonna raise your hand about it. If you can think of really solid answers to two questions. One is, when you go in to see the board, what's the most important goal you have? And the second one is, what are the most important things to leave out of your briefing? How many of you feel reasonably confident you could answer both of those questions? See, I'm using the not many will raise your hand to make it seem like you, like, okay. Anyway, those are two of her questions. She's got two more like that. But I think getting her words on what's the most important thing and what should you leave out are really useful things. And then I'll show you examples of how to do it wrong, how it was done wrong with the consequences, and how to do it maybe better. All right, so first one, what's the big goal? What do you want them to do or feel or say when you leave the room? Fair, reasonable question? So here she goes.
Remember when you're walking into the room to actually present to the board, whether it's a committee or the full board.
How many of you can't hear it? Can you hear all right? Okay, good.
When you're putting together a presentation, remember first, it's really about a lot about you. So you want to make sure you're building that confidence. Be precise and concise in what you do. Make sure you talk about and frame the overall strategy, and then talk about whatever the topic of the day is back to that overall strategy. Eliminate all. When you're putting together a presentation, remember first, it's really about.
Wait, I need to get back to where we were. I just messed up.
When you're putting together a presentation, remember first, it's really about a lot about you. So you want to make sure you're building that confidence. Be precise and concise in what you do. Make sure you talk about and frame the overall strategy, and then talk about whatever the topic of the day is back to that overall strategy. Eliminate all the acronyms.
So we did two and I ran them together. The first one was, what's your big goal? What was it? John also mentioned it. It's a very different goal than the one most people tell me they're gonna do the briefing on. It was that they leave the room trusting that you're the right person in the job. There's no other goal. Everything else is how you accomplish that. They are not smart enough to learn cybersecurity. They're not technical enough to want to learn cybersecurity. The only thing you can have them leave the room with is, she's the right person for the job. She says that, the board member says that to the CIO, the CEO, life is good. That's the goal. So it's how you cause that group of people to respond, I like that guy. Not I like his talk, I like that guy. I think he's the right guy to run this area. Maybe he could even move up. That's the goal. So it's not to inform them about cybersecurity, it's fair. It's to get them to feel that way about you. So now we're working on, I gotta go back, we're working on what do you leave out when you go in to talk to them. So we're trying to figure out if your goal is to get them to trust you, what should you avoid doing, what should you do, and more importantly, what should you avoid doing, because what they remember are the mistakes if you make them. So what are the things you want to avoid?
When you're putting together a presentation, remember first, it's really about a lot about you. So you want to make sure you're building that confidence. Be precise and concise in what you do. Make sure you talk about and frame the overall strategy, and then talk about whatever the topic of the day is back to that overall strategy. Eliminate all the acronyms. Right?
Acronyms.
So I'm going to flip your question around. Acronyms. What shouldn't you do? All right? If you use too many acronyms, if you use too many technical terms, what's going to happen is the board will be confused. When the board is confused, they are not confident. And what did I say was the first objective? Build confidence. So when you're looking at your presentation, this is one of those things where it's great to use family members, right? Put it together and then put it in front of your kid. Do you understand what I'm saying? I mean, I'm really not teasing here, because what happens is you live it so much and you're into it so much that what seems totally obvious to you absolutely may not be. So no acronyms. Please don't put in a whole lot of technical terms. Do not dive too deep into what you're doing. You just want them to understand the strategy, the topic of the day, how it ties to the strategy, and you want to leave them with confidence that it's well managed. We know what our issues are. It's not perfect, and it's fine not to be perfect, but here's the plan. All right? And last but not least, do not scare the board. If you leave the room and their biggest main feeling is one of being scared, again, that means they're probably not confident in you. It's okay to make them understand the importance of the risk and the size of the risk, but make sure you're also then explaining the plan, right? Yes, we have a big risk here. We get X number of tax, we get this, you know, except that's okay, as long as, and here is how we handle it. Here are some of the metrics that show our ability to identify, to contain, right, et cetera. So don't leave them scared, don't leave them nervous, and do not leave them confused. If you're able to do that, then you'll probably be coming back on a regular basis, because this is definitely a topic that's top on their mind.
I'm going to show you actual examples of the charts people use to show their strategy and examples of the charts people use to cause boards to say he was not the right person for that job. So you have a visual thing, but I wanted to explain why I was going to show them to you, because otherwise what's the point in looking at something if you don't know that it might make a difference. But we have two more questions from Shelley. One is, is there a best way to present the data? Is there a standard for comparison? And her answer is no, but if you dig a little deeper into hearing what her words are, you'll see a nugget in there.
Tie it all back to the primary business functions that are critical, and then how the cyber piece overlays it, right? So that's what I mean by talking about it in the terms of business. So I haven't seen a standard one to another, but what I have seen, the ones that go well, are ones where here's our cyber strategy. It's tied to the overlying business strategy, right? It looks to overall risks, and they've identified a series of metrics that we see on a regular basis. So they're educating us through that to say, we're doing well up to the right, these numbers are spiking, so here's what we're doing to address this, that's fine.
So notice she said regular basis, that's the nugget. Don't do new charts every time. Show something that actually matters the way John was showing you, and then show how you're doing better or worse or doing something that's earning your keep, all right? And then the last one is, we already did that one, didn't we? Right.
The boards aren't really gonna give you resources or dollars. We approve an overall budget, but we aren't telling the CEO, move this dollar from here to the here, move that dollar from there to there. They're doing that. So it's really important that you within security are actually having the conversation with the CEO or the CFO, however it works within your company.
Okay, so that last one, I haven't gotten my audio exactly synced the way I wanted it to. We thought that we tested this, but it didn't work right. Her last point was, is this a way to get money? And she said, if you really need more money, and essentially she said, if you really need more money and you don't need your job, then this is a great way to get money. But if you tell them the CEO is not giving you enough money, that is a really good short-term solution to looking for a new job. And when you say, we need more for this, we need more for this, we need more for this, they're not an ATM, remember that line? So what you're saying is the CEO is making bad money allocations. It's just not a great strategy for long-term success. You can, if you know that one person on the board, have long conversations with that person and have them bring it up as, do we need to spend money? But you don't want to be the one telling them that your boss doesn't know what he or she is doing. Okay, so those were the audio. That I just wanted you to know why I'm going to show you the other examples. What I want to do first is show you two slides. These two slides were used by a federal CISO. He has a very large IT security budget. He showed these to an outside board, only one of whom knew anything about security and technology. The rest were finance people and that sort of thing. And I'm going to show you just two of them. They weren't the worst, because I didn't want to make it really awful. So this is the first one. This is his agency IT risk management program, the AITRM. Are there any acronyms on that slide? There are a few words that aren't acronyms, right? We're 100% compliant with NIST, ISCM, and ongoing authorization guidance. This is to a non-cybersecurity, non-technical audience. And then this, the second one is the program integrates capabilities reporting, and look at the bullets. Are there any non-acronym bullets? No, right? So I don't think I have the slide. I was with that board. So there are five people. I can't tell you the agency, but I went out and I went into the bathroom, and the guy who went in with me from the board said, "That arrogant," and then he knows another word, "he didn't say anything I understood. He clearly is not the right person for this job." And about 9 weeks ago, the woman who has his job called me because he doesn't have the job anymore. So I'm just saying, I'm not making up stories about things we don't want to do. And I bet one of you has shown a slide with that kind of detail on it. Just one, not probably no more than one in the room who's done that with their security program, right? Okay. And then last thing is things that might work for you. I'm going to show you four. The first one is from about software development. There's a system called
BSIM.
BSIM, like B S S I M or B S I S M, I think, that Gary McGraw did. Doesn't matter who did it. It's about 150 companies that have shared their data on where they are on different dimensions of software development, secure software development. And the reason I'm showing this to you is that the inside one is where we are, and it's better to go out. And the outside one is where the rest of our industry is. That's a slide that says there's a reference point. We know where we are. We know where we need to be. Get the concept of strategy? Strategy isn't a lot of bull words. It's there's some things we need to do. We know where we are. We know where we need to go. So that should be the words you can summarize your strategy with. We know where we are. We know what our gaps are. We know what we need to do. Here's a second one, one of the largest technology companies in the country. This is a very loved slide. It's the 20 critical controls. It's where they stand on the 20 critical controls on each of them. Red, yellow, green is just a great way to show it. But again, it's we know where we are, we know where we have to be. We know it's important because the 20 critical controls matter. So we know where we are. And I love the part I love best is the blue one, which this person is a very senior person. And she says, you know, that just isn't going to work for us. That kind of guts to say, yeah, those guys make a standard, but it isn't going to work for us, is a part of the way you build trust. Because here's somebody who knows our organization well enough to be able to say to the board, that's true. Here's the third one. This actually put $191 million in the federal budget. This was a measure every 72 hours of how many vulnerabilities were found in the State Department systems. All of them across all countries across the world. All of them measured every 72 hours. The people who can bring those numbers down like that are phenomenal. You know how they did it? No command and control, that doesn't work. The way they did it was by illuminating. You run Botswana, she runs South Africa, you run Egypt, he runs Sudan. They have charts of how each of you are doing every month. And for the first 9 months, they didn't show them to the secretary or anybody. Just you saw them. But they knew in 9 months they were going to get seen by the secretary. Would it change priority for fixing vulnerabilities? I mean, it's just amazing. And any one of you can do that today. That's not I need more money. You all have a vulnerability testing tool. You just don't use it right. Anyway, last thing. I'm going to skip this mostly. If you don't know about using the 20 critical controls, you want to. And the only reason you want to is boards of directors want to know how you know something. And in the 20 critical controls, these were the people who came up with them. The NSA Red Teams, NSA Blue Teams, US CERT, DoD Cybercrime Center, JTF GNO, the people who actually know how attacks work. So if you think you know how attacks work better than the NSA Red Team and Blue Team, you're wrong, because they do the attacks. So they actually know how they work. When you choose what's my strategy going to be, if you don't sort of weave in the 20 critical controls, and that's, by the way, what you do first if you do the NIST framework. The NIST framework, the way you do the NIST framework is the 20 critical controls. But the point is the board can understand that, because they can understand that somebody who actually knows how attacks work can say, here's what you do to stop them. And my last slide is a major, your last example is a major utility. I'm going to start with what happened in the meeting. The CIO himself, who is this guy's boss, told me the story. He said, the chairman of the board told me, that's the first time a security person has made sense. Does that give you a sense that maybe security people don't give great presentations in his organization? Okay. And then, and this was just glorious, he made the CISO's budget base. And the reason we know this, by the way, is this CISO was one of the first students in SANS graduate program. He was one of the first people to make it all the way through SANS master's degree program, and he used this as part of his thesis, so we got to know what he was doing. Otherwise, we wouldn't have gotten a chance to find out. But the base in utilities means it's the same as fixing the wires. You do not have to justify what you're spending. Just do it. Nice? What did he show him? He showed him the thing on the right. He took the 20 critical controls, he put colors on where we stand, and then he had a 3-year plan for how he was going to get the yellows and reds to green. And John updated it with, in case people, you want this slide, he updated it with a new critical control order. But the point is, he said, I know what we need to do, I know what the gaps are, here's how I'm going to spend the money. And the glorious extra bonus he got was every time a vendor came in and tried to sell him something, he could say, sorry, you're not on any of the key things we need to do in the next year, come back in 2 years, which is a really nice thing to do. And with that, I'm out of time. Thank you very much.
Okay, so just want to close with some things we hope you take with you. Have the right data. Capture metrics from your security program that are helping you manage the security program, and then pick the ones that can show upwards to inform and help to drive change. Biggest success factor many CISOs reported to actually initiating change was taking advantage of transitions. Many of you are going to be going to Windows 10 soon. Maybe there's a big reorg. Maybe something's happening in mergers and acquisitions. That's the time to talk upwards to drive some change. The changes you want to do, pick ones that are directly tied to the business, will have some near-term wins, make some changes, and then communicate that upwards. Communicate success stories upwards, and then communicate those outwards to others in the CISO community. So I want to leave you with a couple URLs to more information on that, what works, talked about in the CIS critical security controls. One resource, by the way, that every one of the CISOs said they look at, the National Association of Corporate Directors, is often what your board of directors is reading from or hearing from. $400, you can get a membership in your company and see the same information that's going to your board about cybersecurity, and it's worthwhile. With that, I think we're just about out of time, and we'll leave it for individual questions at the end. Thank you.